Hello and welcome to this interview with Deepika Singh Rajawat. She doesn't need any introduction, obviously. She is the face of one of the biggest cases that that is being fought not only in the corridors of the court, but also in media, in the hearts and minds of all kinds of Indians. Deepika, the Kathua case is literally the lightning rod for a lot of for this fight for justice, the fight for the soul of India, as it were. There has been umpteen number of attempts to communalize the issue, to portray it as some kind of a Hindu versus Muslim issue. You are a Kashmiri Pandit, and you've taken up this case for a little Bakarwal girl who was so brutally gang raped and murdered. The first question is that you've had a wonderful order from the Supreme Court, and you've expressed happiness at the order yesterday, because the order came yesterday. Give us your reaction, and why do you think it was so important to take the case, the Kathua case, out of Jammu and Kashmir?
Thank you so much. We all know what happened since April. Everyone talking about this case, the nation woke up, even the international community started talking about the issue. We were here before the Honorable Supreme Court, rather her father was here before the Honorable Supreme Court for seeking transfer of the trial to some other part of the country. We were not satisfied with what is going in Kathua. We were not satisfied whether the trial would take place peacefully there at Kathua or not. We have seen how on 9th of April, the local lawyers tried to restrain the crime branch team from filing the charge sheet. Even before that also, the rallies were there against this minority community. Then 2 days back only, one minister's vehicle was hit. He was rather attacked. And in such circumstances, the biological father felt that the trial would not go peacefully there at Kathua. And that was the apprehension which actually made us to move an application before the Honorable Supreme Court. And I'm really thankful to Mrs. Indira Jai Singh, her team, for supporting us, for being there with us, for working selflessly on the issue. And today we are able to speak, and yesterday we got a very good order from the Honorable Supreme Court, which transferred the trial to Pathan Court. This little girl belonged to the same category. These Bakarwals, I believe they are from the invisible community. They die unheard, they are never heard, I must say very strongly and with authority. the Honorable Supreme Court yesterday proved that sachai ki jeet hoti hai. I must put it in this way. And unheard is heard now. The principles of fair trial were upheld. If you'll just go through the order, what has been observed in the order, principles of the elements of fair trial, three very important elements of fair trial, that is speedy justice, then protection, and then the protection of the witnesses, then camera trial. This all has been done to ensure a fair trial. When we talk about the day-to-day hearing, I strongly believe, and what I can get is, it is to ensure speedy justice, speedy trial, and avoid delay. When we say delay is there and justice delayed, justice denied, when we say that comes when trial takes a lot of time. So here in this case, the Honorable Supreme Court has already said that it would go on day-to-day hearing, and meaning thereby that justice would be done very soon in this case, and that was the motive for passing this wonderful order that has come by Honorable Supreme Court. And we are really thankful on behalf of the father of the victim. I am extremely thankful to Honorable Supreme Court for giving kind consideration and actually not giving air to the other things that were, you know, there was that were trying to communalize the issue, politicize the issue, though things have not been given air at all.
You know, you just mentioned Ms. Indira Jaisingh's team and her selfless association with this case. But you have been associated with a lawyers collective, you know, even before, and you were part of it. And so tell us a little about that experience and, you know, what all, what are the areas of interest? We know that you have worked in women's rights and you've also worked for human rights in Kashmir, Jammu and Kashmir. So tell us a little bit about that.
You know, when I met Indira Jaisingh, Miss Indira Jaisingh, I call her Indu. When I met Indu first time, it was like I looked at her and said, I want to be like you. And she looked at me and she said, sure. For that, you need to work hard. Yeah, you see, you need to have a mentor. You need to have a guide. That's very important. And I'm really thankful I see Indu as my guide, my mentor. I really want to work like her. I really want to roar like her. At this age, she works so hard. She gives her best. And, you know, I want to actually be like her. And Lawyers Collective, I got an opportunity to work with Lawyers Collective. I was among 15 lawyers from the country that were trained by Mrs. Indira Jaisingh on women rights, and I was among those 15 lawyers. It was an honor to work with Lawyers Collective. I guess they have groomed us that way. They have taught us about rights. I still remember. Ms. Jaisingh once told, she said that you need to be convinced with law before you appear for your client. And then she has been saying one more thing she's been saying that, you know, we lawyers don't have any religion. When we are lawyers, when we wear robes, we don't have any religion. Your Bible, your holy book is your constitution. The constitution of India, and I strongly believe in that, and that was the thing which made me to work for this little girl, this 8-year-old child. Despite the threats, despite the damage that has been caused to me, I'm being tagged with what is not. I still feel that I need to be there, because when I'm a lawyer, I am not Hindu, Muslim, or I don't have a religion that time. So my commitment is there for the child, and I've seen the same commitment coming from Ms. Indira Jaisingh. Yes.
So Deepika, you've formerly worked with in Kashmir. You've worked with the fruit mafia, against the fruit mafia, and you've worked in the landmine cases in Kashmir. So these are, you know, also extremely delicate cases, you know, and you've had a lot of exposure with the vulnerable people who are targeted on, you know, in the garb of these cases, and those who perpetuate these cases, also often in collusion, sometimes in collusion with those, the law enforcement agencies, and sometimes not. So how do you sort of, you know, handle, and how did you handle these cases, and tell us about the experience of your legal experience prior to taking up the Kathua case?
I always feel like, see, I've been a journalist, I've been an activist, I told you I was working with Lawyers Collective, I was working with CRI, Child Rights and You. I always felt like being there. I always felt like raising issues. Yes, I worked with landmine victims, I worked for the compensation, I worked for their rehabilitation. There was a PIL filed by me only before the Honorable High Court at Jammu. I was there, I couldn't see them, you know, in trouble, in pain. And when I say unheard, they also belong to the same category. I've been working for, we recently filed one PIL in the Honorable High Court at Jammu for seeking complete ban on using calcium carbide and other chemicals in ripening the fruits. And we are there before the Honorable Court for, you know, setting up a mechanism that would check the quality of eatables, because I believe that is very important. It when we talk about right to life, then at the same time we should ensure that even the responsibility of the state is to ensure what the quality of the food also, right? And then, you know, this was one case, the lineman victims, and then we've been working on juvenile justice also. I've been working on juvenile justice since 2008. I worked with CRY on the same project. I've been working on children there in militancy affected areas, their rights and other things. We've been working on women rights also. We've been working with the government, with the Jammu and Kashmir police, on creating awareness among the police officers, because I strongly believe until and unless they are well read, they are updated, they can't work. When we speak about law, and when we say that that law is there, this law is there, until the stakeholders are aware, they can't implement it. And you can see implementation until the stakeholders are well read, they understand their role and they understand their responsibility well. So it's very important to work in updating them. It's very important.
Okay, so as you rightly mentioned, the sensitization of the law enforcement forces and even the legal community for that matter is very important. It's not only enough to have to be aware of the laws, but it's also extremely important to absorb what the ultimate aim and objective of those laws, why they exist in the first place, and what is this, there has to be a standardization when it comes to the understanding of law and its applications, right? In that, taking off from that very valuable point, I want to sort of ask you about something that has troubled you in the past, which is your expulsion from the Jammu and from the Bar Association. It was a very traumatic time of your life, but it's also important for us to keep the record and for you to talk about it, because that is only how we can come to terms with something that has happened in the past, and that is how we all learn, when we share, when we learn. So I request you to talk about that very painful episode of your life, and how did you deal with it, and what exactly happened?
It was at the very threshold of my career. I had started my career that time, my legal career that time only. It was 2013 when I was expelled from bar membership. It was taken away from me, bar membership, by Jammu and Kashmir High Court Bar Association, Jammu. I was expelled because I didn't listen to them in a way that I didn't withdraw my support from the parents whose daughter was, she died in suspicious circumstances at the residence of a senior lawyer. It was said that she committed suicide, and I could never understand why would a 12-year-old girl commit suicide. I could never understand. The allegations were vague, I extended all my support to the parents. They wanted a probe. They wanted to know what exactly happened to their 12-year-old girl who wanted to be a doctor. I felt my responsibility again. I felt my responsibility. No, I need to be there. I need to work for them. So that was the reason I started approaching everyone, and we requested for judicial probe also. Though that was not there, they had managed everything perfectly. They managed everything, and then I was told to withdraw my support. I was told not to create hue and cry on this issue. When I said no to them, they expelled me from the from bar. My bar membership was taken away, and everyone was told that she is an undisciplined lawyer. I could never understand fighting for rights being a lawyer. If that is indisciplined, yes, I'll commit this. I'll be like this always. If that isn't being indisciplined, I'll be like this always. Because I strongly believe whoever violates law is my enemy. because I'm governed by the constitution of my country, the basic book of my country, which teaches us rights and duties. If people claim their rights, they need to understand their duties also. I strongly believe in this. And it was not only that they expelled me, they circulated the same order, the expulsion order, in media. And one of the leading dailies of the state carried that expulsion order, saying that she has been expelled because she is an indisciplined lawyer. And indisciplined, they could never explain how indisciplined I was. They could never understand. It was, they could never, you know, explain what I did. It was only that she has been indisciplined and we have expelled her. That actually shattered me for some time. I was actually taken aback, shocked. But then that was kind of a moral booster also. That
still,
yeah,
stronger.
Yeah, that made me stronger. That made me stronger, and that gave me strength to work. And I never stopped my journey. I never stopped working on these issues. I kept on taking up these issues. And today is the condition, like, we are here and I'm talking to you. We've been able to work for this little girl, and yes, truth prevails, and I'm sure that it'll be there in future also.
So, you know, Deepika, there is, you know, again, from that, the point that we made earlier, the whole idea of, you know, absorbing law and what it means. Do you think that you know, the condition in Kashmir right now, or Jammu and Kashmir, is a legal fraternity very divided? I mean, we could see a lot of divisions, but what is your perception, and why those divisions persist? Because, you know, if ideal standards always prevail, you would have lawyers working for the betterment of law and for the betterment of the victims. Why do you think there is so much of division within the legal fraternity?
See, we have seen division within the legal fraternity. It took place only after this child's case. They say they never expressed it in a way, but now we can see cracks are visible. You know, cracks are visible. We can see the cracks. It happened because one part of the, I mean, there are two, you see Hindus and Muslims almost everywhere now, we see it, though I don't talk about this issue. I feel like it's like very sensitive issue to talk about, but then now since it is in front of all of us, so I'm also talking about it. There are Muslim lawyers, who never wanted bar association to announce ban and then hold protests on this issue. And you know, the very basic thing that we need to understand in this case is that lawyers, if they have anything, even this time I'm saying, if they had something to agitate, they had something to, you know, express, and they were aggrieved, and moreover they felt like they are the people who have the responsibility to highlight the issue, I respect them for that. If they feel so, I think for that they need to have willed, rather the proper remedies. There are remedies available. Even still, there are remedies available. They are senior lawyers, and then we need to teach them this. They are well aware of it, but they did not do that. They started protesting. They started agitation. They called suspension of work. That was something which has gone against the legal fraternity. That is something which has sent a very wrong message. And I condemn it. Being a lawyer, I strongly condemn.
You've had also, you know, well, there have been so many attacks, and there also has been solidarity from a lot of sections. And I would say the solidarity, you know, the chart is actually rising now, because you've had wonderful endorsement from you know, British actress Emma Watson very recently, when she tweeted in support of you, and she said all more power to Deepika Singh Rajawat. Do you see an international you know, build up towards, you know, sort of demanding justice in this case, you know, I mean, and it's sort of because what we have seen, the order, you know, in the Supreme Court order, there's also an aspect of monitoring the trial, the monitoring, the investigation and the trial and everything that will go on from henceforth. But do you also see an international campaign which is slowly you know, building up in support of all of you who are working towards seeking justice for this Kathua victim?
It's not only that I have seen it, the nation has seen it, how international community has been there with us seeking justice for this child. I'm really thankful to Emma Watson for her kind support. I tweeted today only, after a long time, I, you know, activated my account, Twitter account, and I, you know, I tweeted, I really thanked the lady, and I said, be there with us always. Yeah, why I said be there with us always, because we require such support in future also. Yeah, I believe, like, it was only after, it was only in April 2018, the nation woke up on this issue for this child. International community, yes, was made aware, and then they extended support. Such support is required, you know, from the nation, across the nation, and from the other parts of the world also, that support is required. And this is the time, you know, to create one voice, you know, to show our strength, to defeat those who have ill motives. This is the time. See, if that child would have not given a name, she had no religion, you see. So for that, if a child, I've seen her photographs, I've seen her, you know, the photographs, how she was killed and how she was dumped. She had mud in her hands, meaning thereby she must have struggled. And for 8 days she was, you know, starved, her ribs were broken, and it was like a painful death. Painful death. 8-year-old child. And then more than that, people coming, attaching lies, politicizing the issue, making it a communal issue. That is the most unfortunate thing which has happened in this case. And I must tell you again, had Ms. Jai Singh been not there, her team not there, it would have been very difficult for us to prove our point. It's only because of her support, her selfless efforts, that we have been able to, you know, today we got this order. And I'm really thankful to her once again. I have seen her, you know, the other day also, she was working till late night, reading all the documents. You know, I've seen how selflessly she has worked in this case. Yeah.
Deepika, final question. So how do you see the Kathua case progressing from here? And do you sort of see, sort of, even though the court has ordered speedy trial, and, you know, that obviously we expect things to take, you know, pick up steam and actually go forward in a time bound manner. But what is your estimate? How long will it take for the family to get justice? Family.
Family has lost their child. Family has lost child. I don't think this damage would be repaired by any means, right? Losing a child is a lifetime pain, right? Yes, now the only thing which remains with them is that they need to see these people's behind the bars. Yes, they are behind the bars, but then actual punishment for them is important, left. The way the Honorable Supreme Court ordered today that it would be a day-to-day hearing without adjournments, I don't think it would take much time. I don't think it would take much time, and we all need to be on, be very alert for this trial, because yes, it has been transferred to Pathan Court, and there also we all have a very positive, very strong role to play if we are actually looking for justice for this child. Yes.
Deepika Singh Rajawat, thank you so much for speaking to us. We wish you all the best in your legal and human rights endeavors, and I hope our association continues for a very long time to come.